He was a hero for catching bad guys and leading the investigation into missing boy William Tyrrell. But when the cop became a criminal, Gary Jubelin's world turned upside down. He explains what came next in a new book called Badness, and Gary joins us in the studio today. Gary, it's always a pleasure when we have you here.
Thanks for having me on.
You were charged with making an illegal recording of a suspect during your investigation into William Tyrrell.
Yeah.
It ended your career. The commissioner called your investigation a mess. Yeah. Do you feel as though someone had it in for you?
I don't relate the two together. That what happened with recording the conversations on my phone, I stand by what I did. The courts judged otherwise. I moved on and I'm doing something different, working in the media and enjoying myself. It was probably 12 months ago, or a little bit under 12 months ago, the commissioner at the time came out and criticised the investigation. An investigation I'd led for 4 years. So I'd been sitting on the sidelines. I think like everyone in the police, all the public, we want to find out what's happened to William. So I was a little bit confused where that was coming from. And certainly the records retained by the police don't support that, because it's an investigation of that nature is well documented, and everyone above me was more than happy with what was being done on the investigation. So it's been an interesting couple of years since. But I do keep getting dragged back into the Tyrrell investigation. But on that, I made a commitment to William's family that I would do everything humanly possible to find out what happened to William when I took over the investigation. And just because I left the police, that hasn't diminished. I'll still do everything I can.
Now, Gary, you say that you've learned that we all have a little violence in us, and you describe the legendary arrest of Michael Murphy, one of Anita Cobby's killers, by Detective Ian Kennedy.
Yeah.
Can you describe that arrest?
Yeah, the arrest, it was... everyone knows the crime. I think it came into the psyche of Sydney when Anita Cobby was murdered. It was a brutal crime. Ian Kennedy is a detective that I've looked up to for years. I know him. I've worked with him. And we're talking about violence, looking at badness from different sides. And, the way that Ian arrested the people, it was aggressive, but it had to be at the time and it was appropriate. But where we're talking about badness is everyone's capable of it. Looking at life since I've left the cops, I've been speaking to a lot of criminals. I still speak to police and victims. But it's been interesting how some of the criminals, now I'm looking or speaking to them and actually looking at them from a different perspective, I'm getting an understanding of why they are so violent.
Yeah, that understanding it's a funny one, I suppose, in the sense that, yeah. I mean, you become friends with a man who tried to bite out a man's throat, Bernie Matthews. Can you tell us about him? How did that friendship come about?
Well, someone put a mutual friend put us in contact together, and when we first met, like, Bernie Matthews was a notorious criminal. He escaped from prison. He was the longest-serving prisoner in Katingal, which was the first supermax. And that incident was when he was at his lowest, and he tried to kill a corrective services officer by biting through his throat. Now, what am I doing sitting speaking to him? He was an armed robber as well. I worked in the armed robbery squad. We were almost to-ing and fro-ing with each other. But as the barriers broke down, I become to understand him as a human and his childhood and what he experienced going through boys' homes and in early days in prison. And he doesn't make excuses for the crimes he's committed, and I certainly don't condone it. But you get an understanding of why he turned violent. It's not making an excuse, but it's trying to understand it.
Yeah. Now, and we saw the Chris Dawson, that Chris Dawson was convicted last week of murdering his wife, Lynette.
Mm.
He wasn't investigated until 9 years later. I mean, do you think those cops should be held accountable?
I think when you're investigating someone's murder, disappearance in that circumstance at the time, you should be held accountable. It's a very serious obligation you take up when you're investigating someone's disappearance or murder. I think we need to learn by mistakes, if mistakes were made. It was 40 years down the track. I sort of focus on the positive there. It's sort of sending out a message that, hey, it doesn't matter how long ago you committed this offence, we might still be coming after you, the police might still be coming after you. But I think if any investigation, there's probably room for improvement. I always tried to critique investigations that I did. What could have we done better? So we can learn.
Yeah.
Right. Now, I don't mean to throw this on you, but we heard in the news today that Detective Cameron Blaine, one of the detectives who found the missing Cleo Smith in WA, has been stood down in wake of alleged misconduct.
Yeah, I heard that, and a lot of people have pointed it out to me. And I think it's almost... I don't know anything about it, so I'll preface my comments on that basis. But it's almost like a poison chalice in the police. You stick your head up and things tend to happen. What's happened there, I don't know. I hope there's nothing in it and he can get back. Clearly, he was doing good work recovering the child, so I hope he can get back and do that. But I haven't got any inside knowledge of it.
Thank you for that. I appreciate you answering as well. Now, Gary Jubelin's new book is called Badness. You don't want to miss this one, guys. Gary, thank you so much for joining us today. Really appreciate it. We'll keep an eye on this one. All the best.